Thank you, Wendy. It's great to see you all here. I have the great delight of introducing you to someone I regard as one of the finest public advocates for the Christian faith in the world today. Rebecca McLaughlin has a degree in theology from Oak Hill, London, and a PhD in Renaissance literature from the University of Cambridge, where she studied prisons in the works of Shakespeare. There you go. She now lives in the other Cambridge in Massachusetts, here in the US. She's lived here maybe 15 years, 16 years. With her husband Brian and their three children, she has a very busy family life. She has a wide speaking ministry around the world. And she writes, it seems to me, about a book every year, which is depressing as someone who tries to write books. Her first book was Confronting Christianity, and it was described in Outreach magazine as the best all-round defense of the Christian faith in a decade. Now, that was my review of her book in Outreach magazine, but it is nonetheless true. She's since published the book Secular Creed, Jesus Through the Eyes of Women, and her newest one is No Greater Love, which is a reflection on the lost art of friendship. Now, you're going to see in a moment that her literary and theological backgrounds just shine through with a beauty and a clarity of thought about such diverse topics. Racism, sexuality, science, heaven and hell, violence. And really the guiding question through all that she does, it seems to me, is does Christianity still make sense despite everything? And that is sort of the topic we've got her talking about tonight. I mean, Christianity is very old, and in some circles it's lost popularity. But does that mean it's out of date and out of touch? Well, we're about to hear, I think. Please welcome Dr. Rebecca McLaughlin.
Gosh, you can't get rid of the foreigners around here, can you? You know, these guys coming in from Australia as if they have something to say. Oh, what arrogance, that's what I say. The beauty, so when I married a guy from Oklahoma, I'm just going to give you a second to process that because I know it's really hard for people to wrap their heads around. They're like, how did you meet? I get this like shocked expressions. And one of his arguments as to why we should move, we met in England, why we should move back to his homeland, not Oklahoma specifically, but the United States of America, was that in America, people would like me for no reason because of my accent. So I've been trading on this for the last 16 years. The only problem is, I'm pretty sure I was funnier in England, because you know how a lot of jokes depend on the exact way you pronounce a word or the exact cultural context? And I'd be like, here's my funny joke, and Americans are like, we don't pronounce it that way. What are you talking about? Or like, that's not a word. I'm like, oh gosh. So I think in America, I seem more intelligent than I am, but I'm also seem less funny than I am. So, you know, gotta take what you can get. Because I'm English though, one of the problems we have as a culture is that we really can't help talking about Harry Potter. So before I speak, I need to ask you guys, raise your hand if you have never read the books or seen the films of Harry Potter. Okay. Raise your hands if you haven't, but you plan to. Oh, I'm so sorry. Okay. Oh, I feel terrible now. Because the illustration I'm going to give you in just one second is going to be a terrible, terrible Harry Potter spoiler. If my five-year-old, who I'm reading the books with right now, was here, I would have to send him out of the room. He would be gone anyway. He'd be so bored at this point. But so if you haven't read the books or seen the films, like truly I want you to leave the room just for a couple of minutes, or maybe your dad can like block your ears. I hate this. Oh, okay. If you have read the books or seen the films, you'll know that in Harry Potter and the Half-Blood Prince, J.K. Rowling basically like sticks a knife into her readers' hearts. Dumbledore is the Gandalf of the series, for those who are more Tolkien fans. He's the only man whose power for good can match Lord Voldemort's evil. But in the sixth book, a weakened Dumbledore stands at the top of the astronomy tower, surrounded by his enemies, and he appeals to Harry's teacher nemesis, Severus Snape, for help. Severus, please. And Snape kills him. You weren't blocking your ears. The scene is completely devastating. We never liked Professor Snape, but we hope beyond hope that he was Dumbledore's man, and now his betrayal of his mentor is complete. It's only in the last book that we realize how wrong we were. When Harry dives into the Pensieve, this sort of magical bowl where you can dive into somebody else's past. And there we discover that everything Snape has done has been driven by his passionate, hopeless, unrequited love for Harry's mother. We see Snape's anguish when Lily Potter is murdered by Voldemort and how he thenceforth commits himself to Dumbledore. We hear Dumbledore telling Snape that he is dying from the slow workings of an irreversible curse and making Snape promise to kill him when the moment comes. And suddenly the meaning of Severus, please, is reversed. I don't know where you're coming from today when it comes to the question of Christianity and more particularly the question of Jesus Christ. But where I live in Cambridge, Massachusetts, I have many neighbors and friends who, when they look over at the Christian faith, they see an awful lot of things that look like Snape killing Dumbledore. They see a white-centered religion with a history of racism and scriptures that condone slavery. They see an anti-intellectual mindset and a contradictory Bible that's been disproved by science again and again. They see homophobia, the denigration of women, and a refusal to acknowledge that love is love. But just as when Harry dived into that Pensieve, his perception of what Snape had done completely reversed. So I think that when we look more closely, that each of these seemingly devastating roadblocks to faith in Jesus actually becomes a signpost. Now, again, I don't know how you would identify yourself religiously today and how you feel about what seems like the decline of Christianity in the Western world today. My guess is there are some people here who feel like the best thing that Christians can do right now is to sort of batten down the hatches and cling on for dear life while the waves of secularization wash over us. That the tide is just simply going out on Christianity. But if that's what we think, however we feel about that, I think we've got it actually quite wrong. I don't think the tide is going out on Christianity, I think it's coming in. But in order to recognize this, there are four things that we need to do. Number one, we need to rethink diversity. Number two, we need to rethink the university. Number three, we need to rethink morality. And number four, we need to rethink sexuality. But if you, like me, are a follower of Jesus, then we need to do all these things with humility and not actually by watering the Bible down, but by lapping it up. So number one, we must rethink diversity. On the 23rd of February 2019, a Nigerian street preacher named Olawale Ilasanmi stood outside a train station in my hometown of London, preaching to the commuters as they went by. Two white British police officers came up to him and gave him a choice: go away or be arrested. I will not go away, Mr. Ilasanmi replied, because I need to tell them the truth, and Jesus is the only way, the truth, and the life. They don't want to listen to that, the officer said. They want you to go away. You don't want to listen to that, Mr. Ilasanmi replied. You will listen when you are dead. You will listen when you are dead. And so he was arrested. What do we make of this story? My guess is a lot will depend on where we're coming from religiously. from my perspective as a Christian, as I hear this story, I'm deeply encouraged by my brother's faith. I'm reminded that actually, according to the Bible, preaching the message of Jesus always comes at a cost, and that Western Christians like me have got far too used to a comfortable life. But a black African Christian preaching the exclusive message of Jesus while white Westerners block their ears, it's actually a little parable for the religious world today. See, 40 years ago, sociologists of religion, however they felt about this, they thought that as the world became more modern, more scientific, more educated, that religious belief would naturally decline. It's what had happened in Western Europe, where I'm from. And where Western Europe leads, the rest of the world must follow, right? Wrong. Not only in the last 40 years has religion in general and Christianity in particular failed to decline globally, but now as experts look out over the next 40 years, they anticipate an increasingly religious world. So right now, Christianity is the largest global belief system, with about 31% of the world identifying as Christian. That proportion is set to increase slightly to 32% by about 2060. The second largest belief system in the world is Islam. And Islam is set to grow from around 25% to about 31%, making it a very close competitor of Christianity. Hinduism and Buddhism are both set to decline a little over that time. But here's the real shock. The proportion of people who do not affiliate with any major religion, so that includes atheists, agnostics, or people who would just check none on their census form if you ask them, what's your religion? That proportion is set to decline from 15% to 13%. Now, the tide isn't actually going out on religion globally, it's coming in. This comes as a surprise to actually many of my friends who are not Christians. But what's perhaps even more surprising to them is that Christianity is the belief system of diversity. If you look across the world today, you'll find that Christianity is not only the largest, but also the most diverse, whether you're looking at race or culture or geography or socioeconomic status. If we look in America today, in some people's minds, Christianity is sort of strongly associated with a particular white Western culture, whether in the UK or in the US. But if you look at America demographically today, black Americans are as much as 10 percentage points more likely to identify as Christian than their white peers. They're more likely to go to church every week, they're more likely to read their Bible, they're more likely to pray, they're more likely to hold core evangelical beliefs about Jesus, whether or not they would use that particular terminology. A lot of Americans think that immigration is eroding America's Christian heritage. In actual fact, immigration is a much-needed blood transfusion for the American church. As John mentioned, I live in Cambridge, Massachusetts, and in Somerville, which is one of the adjacent cities, English is the third most commonly spoken language at evangelical churches after Portuguese and Creole. So if you, like me, as somebody who actually cares about diversity, somebody who is drawn to the beautiful vision of people from different racial, cultural, ethnic, geographic backgrounds coming together and having a basis for community, then don't dismiss Christianity. Because at a purely sort of empirical level, if we look around the world today, we'll find that Christianity is offering us more diversity than anything else. Now, if you want to open up a Bible, you'll find that this is not surprising at all. See, the first century Jewish man I worship broke through every racial and cultural barrier of his day, and he commanded his disciples to go and make disciples of all nations, and they began almost at once. We meet the first African Christian in the New Testament, in the book of Acts, the Ethiopian eunuch in Acts chapter 8. And Ethiopia, interestingly, went on to become one of the first officially Christian countries in the world, before St. Patrick ever went to Ireland and centuries before the gospel came to America. In the last book of the Bible, this beautiful and strange book called the Book of Revelation, we see this incredible vision of people from every tribe and tongue and nation worshiping Jesus together. If you're a follower of Jesus, this is your destiny. And in many ways, actually, if we look around the world today, it is becoming our reality. Now, don't get me wrong. I'm not trying for a minute to whitewash or gloss over the history of sort of race-based injustice. But far too many times in the history of this country, in the history of my country, when self-confessed Christians have acted in completely unbiblical ways toward people of different racial backgrounds, in particular toward Black Americans, for instance. But I can open up my Bible and I can diagnose that as profoundly wrong, precisely because I believe what the Bible says, precisely because I'm a follower of Jesus. So if in your mind, Christianity is associated with racism, and maybe you've seen that in the course of your own life, or you've seen that in the lives of your friends, or you've seen that as you open up history books, I understand. I get that the data is there. But I would encourage you to look not only at that data, but actually at the broader picture and at the scriptures themselves, to see that Christianity isn't against diversity. Christianity is, in fact, the most multiracial, multiethnic, multicultural movement in all of history. Second, and appropriately for a university campus like this, we need to rethink the university. A few years ago, I invited a friend of mine who I met in grad school in the UK, who is now a professor of the natural sciences at Harvard. He's like so smart that he doesn't even get confined to one science subject. He's a professor of the natural sciences. And he and I met in grad school in England. He is a culturally Jewish, convictionally atheist guy. And he and I have been sort of arguing about questions of faith for the last 20 odd years. And I invited him to an event at Harvard where the agnostic chair of the Harvard philosophy department was going to be in dialogue with a New Testament scholar called N.T. Wright. And the title of the event was The Bible, Gospel, Guide, or Garbage. And after the event, I said to my friend, I know that you think that what I believe is crazy. His then-girlfriend, who is a much gentler soul than either of us, said, I'm sure he doesn't think that. I said, yes, he does. I believe that the whole of human history revolves around this first century Jewish man who died on a cross and was supposedly raised to life 3 days later. Crazy, right? My friend said yes. I said, the problem is, I think that you believe some crazy things as well. You see, my friend and perhaps some others in this room right now, it's easy to think that we're comparing Christianity with all those crazy beliefs about people rising from the dead to a perfectly coherent secular worldview that does all the work that Christianity does, but without having to believe in crazy stuff. But the more I have read of atheist and agnostic thinkers in recent years, the more evident it is to me that there isn't that coherent alternative. That actually, we're comparing crazy with crazy. And Christianity actually makes the most sense of the different pieces of our world, not only for ourselves individually, but even as we think academically. And I'll unpack some of that in this point and in the next point. Because you see, my friend, who is a science professor, believes deeply in science. And in many people's minds, science is offering us a kind of alternative to belief in a creator God. But in actual fact, if we look at the history of science, we will find that the scientific revolution was driven by people who believed in the creator God of the Bible. In fact, there's a professor at Princeton University called Hans Halvorsen, who's probably one of the top four philosophers of science in the world. And he points out that not only was it the case that Christians first developed what we now call science, but he says that even today, science rests more firmly on Christian philosophical foundations than on atheist ones. In fact, he says, atheism doesn't give you a philosophical foundation for science at all. The best that you can say as an atheist is, I'm so glad that it works. Whereas the people who first sort of formulated what we now call science, they believe that there was a one God who created the whole universe, and they knew from the Bible that this God was the kind of God who is both rational and free. He is a God who gives consistent moral laws. And so they thought, I wonder if this God who gave consistent moral laws also created his universe to run upon consistent laws. And then the job of a scientist is to figure out what those laws are. But because the God who made the universe is also free, he could create a universe any way he liked. So the way to go and figure out how he actually did it is to go and look. You can't just sort of sit in your armchair and imagine it. Now, don't get me wrong. Again, there are many world-class scientists who are, like my friend, convictionally atheist. But there are also many world-class scientists who are very serious followers of Jesus. I was chatting with one earlier this week. I have a podcast, and I interview various of my friends on various topics. And I was chatting with a guy named Ian Hutchinson, who is a professor at MIT. I live a short walk from Massachusetts Institute of Technology, otherwise known as the sort of High Temple of Science in America. And he became a Christian, having grown up in a non-Christian family in the UK. He became a Christian when he was an undergraduate at Cambridge University. And he was actually baptized in King's College, Cambridge, which is, fun fact, is where I got married. So we both had major life events happening in the same rather extraordinary building. He's one of dozens of world-class scientists who I've had the privilege of knowing personally because of previous work that I did, who are very serious followers of Jesus, and many of them actually weren't just raised Christian and sort of never quite managed to kick the habit, but many of them actually came to serious faith in Jesus when they were students or even when they were already professors. In fact, Ian said when he went to do his PhD in Australia, sort of fun fact, his PhD advisor in Australia, who was in his 50s, had just become a Christian as well, by pure kind of happenstance. So we need to not buy into the idea that you sort of have to choose between being a scientist and being a Christian, or that really all the world-class scientists in the world surely have figured out that Christianity is just like intellectually non-credible, because actually many of them haven't, and they don't seem like they're going to. So what about other areas of study? Well, if you think about it, Christians have written some of the greatest literature of all time. I spent 7 years of my life studying it. Christians have dreamt up some of the greatest philosophy of all time. And Christians have, in many ways, been at the foundation of the intellectual sort of project to where many of the top universities in the world today were founded specifically to bring glory to Jesus. And that includes Harvard, which I sort of have to spit when I say the word Harvard, just, you know, to show a little valid contempt for them. You know, whether it's Harvard or Cambridge or Oxford or Yale, universities were specifically founded, like this one, to bring glory to God. And one of the things that's going to have to happen if the academy in the West is going to be truly intellectually honest with itself in the coming years is Western academics are going to have to reckon with the fact that the secularization hypothesis, that idea I mentioned a few minutes ago, that as the world became more modern, more educated, more scientific, that surely religious belief would decline, they're going to have to reckon with the fact that that hypothesis has failed. In fact, there's a professor at Purdue University called Fengang Yang, who's an expert in sociology of religion in China. And he says that the universities in the West are going to have to go through a paradigm shift, much like a scientific revolution, when the failure of that secularization hypothesis really comes home to roost. In other words, between now and when my youngest, who's 5, is in university, there's going to have to be an earthquake in the university. And again, actually, if we open the pages of the Bible, this shouldn't surprise us. Because Jesus called his followers to love God with all their heart and soul and mind and strength. And actually, if we look back over the last 2,000 years, we will see that Christianity isn't anti-intellectual. But in fact, it's the greatest intellectual movement in all of history. Third, we must rethink morality. Before Brian and I met each other, we were both friends with a young woman who at the time was called Sarah Irving. Sarah comes from Australia, like my brother John over here, and she had been raised in a very loving, non-Christian home. Her dad's a history professor. She was extremely intelligent, extraordinarily nice, and unreasonably beautiful, which shouldn't be a thing, really. Like, pick two out of three if you must, but like three, it's just too much, you know, settle down. And when she came to Cambridge to do her PhD in history of science, she was a convinced atheist. And that was when she knew both me and Brian. She was actually one of the few people who knew us before we knew each other. So she was a convinced atheist when she came to Cambridge. She was a convinced atheist when she went to Oxford to do her postdoctoral work. But while she was at Oxford, she went to a series of lectures that were given by a fellow Australian, a very well-known philosopher called Peter Singer. Now, Peter Singer is one of the atheist philosophers who takes seriously the fact that you cannot just sort of keep trading on Christian ethics while not believing in God. And so, for instance, rather than saying that all human beings are fundamentally morally equal by virtue of being human, Peter Singer says that we should evaluate beings, whether they're human or not, on the basis of their capacities. For example, their capacity to suffer, their capacity for self-awareness, etc. And by Peter Singer's calculation, a human infant is less morally valuable than an adult pig. Now, as my friend Sarah heard these lectures, she experienced what she later described as sort of intellectual vertigo, as she realized that her atheism, far from grounding her deepest moral beliefs, actually stuck a knife into the back of them. You see, she thought that Christianity was, if anything, the enemy of universal human rights and care for the poor and equality for men and women and love across racial difference. But she gradually discovered it was the basis for those things. And she ended up becoming a Christian. I've read a couple of books in the last few years by people looking at history from an atheist perspective or from an agnostic perspective and coming to the conclusion that actually the moral beliefs that I'm pretty confident that you and I all hold, regardless of how you might identify religiously, that they actually come to us from Christianity. So one is by a British historian called Tom Holland. The historian Tom Holland, not Spider-Man Tom Holland. Different guy. And Tom Holland, an agnostic himself, stopped believing in the Christian God when he was a boy. He said he was much more interested in the Greek and Roman gods than in the sort of hero of Christianity. And a few years ago, he set out to write a book, which in America is called Dominion, How the Christian Revolution Remade the World. It's about this fat. So if you're into big books, I recommend it. And in that book, he is looking at the last 2,000 years of Christian history in the West. And one of the conclusions that he came to as he did his research was that the moral beliefs that he held as an agnostic were in fact not self-evident truths, but Christian beliefs. They'd been introduced by this strange Jewish sect 2,000 years ago, and they'd sort of infiltrated the world to where today, at least in Western contexts, even if somebody identifies as an atheist or an agnostic or as a Muslim or as a Hindu, most likely there will be shared moral beliefs that have come to us all from Christianity. Or I think of another book by an Israeli historian and philosopher, Yuval Noah Harari. So slightly less fat, but still quite fat book called Sapiens, A Brief History of Humankind. Has anybody read that one? Well done. It's a global bestseller. Apparently a lot of people have bought it. Whether they read it or not is a whole other question. But in that book, Harari will make statements like this. He says, Homo sapiens has no natural rights, just as chimpanzees, hyenas, and spiders have no natural rights. He calls human rights figments of our fertile imagination. Quoting the US Declaration of Independence, you know, we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. Harari says, well, the Americans got the idea of universal human equality from Christianity, but if we stop believing in a God who made human beings and gave them souls and all that jazz, then what does it even mean to say that human beings are equal? He says the scientific study of Homo sapiens has embarrassingly little to do with human rights and equal value. It's striking when you think about it. I think in many people's minds, I don't know if you've ever played Jenga, I sometimes play Jenga with my kids. My five-year-old always calls it Junga, and I can't kind of break him out of the habit. When you're playing Jenga or Junga, you know how you kind of take a little brick out of the bottom and you try to build a higher tower? Somebody nod, because I feel like, okay, thank you. Thank you, appreciate it. I think in a lot of people's minds today, they might think, yeah, I mean, sure, people may have got some moral ideas from Christianity in the first place, but like, surely we can take Jesus out of the foundation and make an even higher moral tower. Actually, no, it's more like pulling the pin on a grenade. Everything goes up in the explosion. In fact, I can never forget the striking speech that a professor at MIT made a few years ago at an event that I was part of, where there was sort of two Christian professors and two professors, one I think identified as atheist, the other as agnostic, who were talking about their beliefs. And one of the agnostic professors, whose name is Alan Knightman, said this: our consciousness and our self-awareness create the illusion that we have some special ego power, some I-ness, some unique existence, when in reality we are nothing but bones, tissues, gelatinous membranes, electrical impulses, and chemicals. We are stuff, like donuts, he said. And if all you have to say about a human being is what can be assessed by the tools of science, he is right. We are stuff, like donuts, with delusions of selfhood. We haven't even only lost all our deepest moral beliefs. We've even lost the I who might hold those beliefs. Now, don't get me wrong. Christians in the last 2,000 years have often fallen short of the incredible ethics that Jesus calls us to. In fact, in some ways, it's sort of built into the understanding of every Christian. In order to become a Christian, you need to recognize that you're not basically a good person who maybe sometimes makes mistakes. You need to recognize that you're actually so bad that you needed the Son of God to come and die for you. It's a pretty unflattering perspective on who I am and who you are. And this same Son of God who came into the world to die for you and for me also let us in on the truth of the moral world, the perfect moral standards that the perfect God who made the world has set. And the bad news is that we don't just fall a little bit short of those standards, we fall basically flat on our face. And my sense often when talking with people who maybe are not Christians themselves, but have been raised especially in parts of the US where many people around them would identify as Christian, is that one of their first associations for Christians is hypocrisy. Or at best, a sense that Christians are saying, I think I'm a better person than you are. You know, come and be a good person like me. Actually, that's really the opposite of the Christian message. I love how the Apostle Paul put it in one of his letters that's recorded in the New Testament. He said, this is a trustworthy saying, worthy of full acceptance, that Jesus Christ came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the foremost. There's no way to share the message of Christianity while holding on to your self-righteousness. And I think if you, like me, are a follower of Jesus, we need to be really careful that that's not what we're communicating to those around us. You know, come and be a good person like me. At the same time, if we look back at the last 2,000 years and if we look across the world today, we need to recognize that not only has Christianity set the standards by which people judge history, for example, the fact that we think genocide is wrong, or the fact that we think sexual exploitation of women is wrong, or the fact that we think the rich and the strong and the powerful don't have the right to trample on the weak and the poor and the marginalized, but instead should protect and provide for them, or the idea that love across racial differences is true and good and beautiful, or the idea that men and women are fundamentally morally equal, you know, that would have been a ridiculous idea for many people in the ancient world. Where was I going with that? Oh, yes, yeah, I'm here. Okay, don't worry, I've been up since 5:15, but it's still all happening here. not only has Christianity sort of set the moral standards, but actually, even Richard Dawkins, who is sort of well-known atheist from my homeland, you know, one of the leading figures in the new atheist movement of the early 2000s, even he has had to acknowledge the data which shows that people who are actively religious are actually behave better than people who are not. And you can kind of look at that over various different criteria, if you will. But it turns out that believing there is a God to whom you are accountable and who might actually, you know, believing there is a real moral universe that you have to conform to, turns out to actually be better aligned with pro-social behavior and less aligned with people behaving extraordinarily poorly toward each other. So in our hurting world today, I think those of us here who are Christians need to reclaim morality, kind of like divers pulling treasure from a wreck, and flee self-righteousness like toxic waste. And those of us here who are not followers of Jesus, it might just be worth reading some of those leading thinkers who are pointing out that actually perhaps some of the things you hold dearest in your heart in terms of your moral beliefs have come to you from Christianity. And that if Jesus isn't who he claims to be, your foundation for them may have just sort of quietly crumbled away. Fourth and lastly, we need to rethink sexuality. When Snape killed Dumbledore, all doubt in the reader's mind as to whether he was on the side of good or evil died as well. And when I stand for Christian sexual ethics in Cambridge, Massachusetts today, I move over in people's minds from delusion to bigotry. But just as when Harry dived into Snape's memories, he found that Snape's was not a story of hate, but a story of love. I believe that when we dive into what the Bible has to say about sexuality, we'll find that it's a love story too. It's just a much bigger love story than we were ready for. The love story begins in the Old Testament scriptures as prophet after prophet compares God to a loving, faithful husband and Israel, his people, to an all too often unfaithful wife. And time and again, God's people keep sort of cheating on him with other so-called gods. And this marriage seems to be in crisis. And then Jesus steps onto the stage of human history. And one of the many strange things that Jesus said was that he is the bridegroom. It's actually a very odd thing to say for a man who never married in his life on earth. So what is Jesus talking about? Well, it's one of the ways in which he's stepping into the shoes of the creator gods of the Old Testament. Jesus is saying, I'm the bridegroom. I've come to claim God's people for myself. As the New Testament proceeds, we come across one of Paul's letters to the church in Ephesus, where Paul describes Christian marriage as being like a little scale model of Jesus' love for his people. And this love song rises to a full-blown crescendo in the book of Revelation at the end of the Bible, when this great shout goes out, the wedding of the Lamb has come, referring to Jesus, and Jesus' marriage to his church brings heaven and earth back together. This actually, biblically, is why marriage is male-female and why husbands and wives are called to different roles. Like Christ and the church, it's a love across difference. Like Christ and the church, it's a love built on sacrifice. Like Christ and the church, it's a life-creating, flesh-uniting, never-ending, exclusive love. Marriage is meant to point us to Christ. But it's also meant to disappoint us. Because actually, even the best human marriage could only be a tiny echo of Jesus' love for us if Jesus is who he claims to be. And one of the things we need to recognize as well, if we're going to look at what the Bible says, is that marriage isn't the only human relationship that is designed to point us to Jesus' love. The night that Jesus was betrayed to his death, he said to his disciples, "This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that he laid down his life for his friends." And people will sometimes say that Christians, people like me who are setting their faith on what the Bible teaches, don't have any vision for love between people of the same sex. Actually, as somebody who's wanting to live by what the Bible says, I would say I have a beautiful and glorious vision of love between people of the same sex. But it's the Bible offers us a different vision for love between people of the same sex than it does for love between a husband and wife in marriage. If you read through the New Testament documents, the Gospels and the New Testament letters, you will find a handful of references to the love between a husband and a wife, and a handful of references to the love that parents should have for their children. And you will find buckets and buckets full of commands to Christians to love each other as brothers and sisters. I'm not saying any of this is sort of easy or straightforward. Some of you who maybe were here this afternoon when I was talking to some of the students about these issues may know this, but as long as I can remember I've been a Christian, as long as I can remember I've been attracted to other women. I think if I were not a Christian, it's most likely I'd be married to a woman today rather than to a man. So I didn't come to the Bible hoping that it said no to same-sex sexual relationships for Christians. There would have been a time in my life when I'd been more than happy if it had said yes. But what I realized that the more that I have drilled into what the Bible actually says, and the more that I've experienced the goodness of that in lived-out Christian community, the more I've realized the Bible isn't calling us to less love. It's actually calling us to more. And the shrunken and impoverished view of love is the view of love which says the only love that counts is sexual and romantic love. And that's a view that very much exists in sort of the broader culture today, but it's also a view that, if we're honest, those of us who are Christians, I think exists all too often in church contexts where that view is just baptized in marriage. In actual fact, the Bible offers us this beautiful and glorious vision for marriage that is not actually mostly about me and my husband making each other happy. It's mostly pointing to Jesus and his people. And the Bible offers us an even greater view of singleness. Now, how can that possibly be? We live in a culture where the strong message is, if you are not sexually and romantically fulfilled, then you're just missing out on life. And again, I think often in Christian circles, that gets baptized as kids are told, you know, one day you'll get married, and then, like, marriage is the goal, the end point, the sort of telos, to use a fancy Greek word, of human existence. But actually, no. According to the Bible, doesn't matter if you're following Jesus as a single person or as a married person, in both states, you can be pointing to the love that Jesus has for us. Because as a single person, you're pointing to the sufficiency of that love. And you're pointing to the day, one day, according to the Bible, Jesus is going to come back, and there won't be marriage anymore. In fact, all of us who are followers of Jesus will live together as one body, as his bride altogether, and as brothers and as sisters. So how does that then kind of reframe how we think about sexuality? I think it does that in so many ways. I could tell so many stories of friends of mine in Cambridge, Massachusetts. I don't actually quite know why this is, but it seems like not only my church, but like my particular community group, Bible study, seems to sort of attract people who, like me, are attracted to people of their same sex. And some people have come because they've read a book I wrote. Most people, it's just pure happenstance. They've showed up and then sort of discovered, oh, this is something that we can kind of talk about in this community. That's interesting. And in one instance, a young woman joined our community about 6 months ago, and she has multiple tattoos of naked women on her body from a period of her life when she was dating other women. And a couple of weeks into Christian community with us, she came up to me and she said, "Oh, I've just realized you guys have to love me." I said, "Yes." She said, "I could go anywhere. I could join any other group in Boston. And people could get to know me and decide that I was weird and they didn't want me anymore. But you guys have to love me." I said, "That's true." I said, "The problem is you have to love us too." And one of the things that she has experienced as she has come into the Christian community, having had a series of sexual romantic relationships of various kinds, is that she's now experiencing this love in a way that she's never experienced it before. In fact, the day that she was baptized, she said to me, "I have never in my life experienced more love from more people than I am today." I could tell you story after story. We could be here all night, and I won't because I know we want to do some Q&A, of people who have chosen to follow Jesus and know that following Jesus means turning away from their sexual and romantic fulfillment. The reality is actually for any follower of Jesus, it's going to mean most likely saying no to at least some of your attractions in the course of your life, kind of regardless of who you might be attracted to. And yet seeing in those people's lives not a sense of disappointment and disillusionment and loneliness and lack of love, but actually the recognition that no, as I throw myself into the arms of the one man who loved me enough to die for me, I also find around me the arms of his people here. So as I said, I wanted to get to Q&A in just a minute, but just to recap, I would challenge you if you're thinking about the claims of Christianity, or if frankly you've dismissed Christianity long ago for some of the reasons that we've mentioned tonight, then maybe it's worth taking the time to rethink diversity, rethink the university, rethink morality, and rethink sexuality. Because Jesus is actually not a relic of the ancient world. He is our modern world's best hope. Thank you.
Thank you, Rebecca. We'll have our chairs out in a moment. So it's very simple. If you've got a question, just line up behind one of the mics in the aisle. And please ask your question succinctly. That means we'll get through more questions. It'll also mean you're more popular in the audience tonight. But any question is allowed. There's nothing that Rebecca's not willing to hear and have a go at answering. So please get to the mics and we'll kick off. I'm thinking not out of touch, not out of date. Did I pick that up?
I hope so. Yeah. Otherwise I really flubbed it.
Yes, sir. A question.
Oh, I'm Derek Anderson. I'm a sophomore in the communication department.
Hey.
My question is, how does someone preach the word of God and continue to preach the word of God, but they struggle with hypocrisy?
Sorry, how does somebody who struggles with the hypocrisy of others, or somebody who themselves...
With themselves.
With themselves.
Yes.
Do you know, that is a question close to my heart, because there are many people who have stood up on a stage like this, given talks like this, many times, you know, people who have toured the world or toured the country or like pastored a church or whatever, who can talk a really good talk about Jesus and whose lives are utterly out of joint with that. And as I think about myself, I mean, in the last sort of few years that I've been doing more kind of public speaking and public writing stuff, I've been aware of the fact that I could become one of those people. And it is vital that I make sure that what happens in my actual kind of life in Cambridge, in my community, in my sort of internal life, as well as in my kind of relational local life, is aligned with what I'm saying. Now, I hope that I'm clear whenever I speak to say, I'm not standing up here as somebody who is not a sinner. I'm standing up here as somebody who is a sinner. Mm. And part of being a Christian is recognizing that you're a sinner. Not just once upon a time you were a sinner and then Jesus saved you, but actually today. For me, one of the key ways in which I try to guard against hypocrisy is having a handful of people in my life who I tell all my worst things to, and who I give full permission to challenge, rebuke, and correct me, and vice versa. I think sometimes when Christian leaders of whatever kind get themselves into terrible, sort of dramatic and ongoing sin, it's correlated with them not actually having their relational needs met in a healthy, biblical way. And I don't ever want to be that.
Don't be shy. Feel free to jump in front of the mic, and while you do, hopefully. Rebecca, do you see any differences between the UK and America in terms of doubt and skepticism toward Christianity? Are they the same questions and criticisms, or are there slight differences here in the US?
Do you know, it's kind of tricky because the US is such a diverse place, as you know, when it comes to people's experience of Christianity. The UK is a far more secular country in terms of like the number of people who show up to church and the number of people who would sort of identify Christianly. So I think there's probably more in the UK of people who simply have no idea about Christianity. I mean, not that they haven't ever heard of Christianity, but they truly, when I was speaking with Cambridge students a couple of months ago, some of whom just like really just didn't know what Christianity was. And it was more like talking to somebody who perhaps had moved here from mainland China and hadn't really been exposed to Christianity than talking to somebody who was raised, you know, most parts of the US, there's at least some kind of familiarity with what Christianity is. So even before we've got to the questions of like, what are the main barriers to belief, I think there's just kind of an ignorance. And I'm not using that term pejoratively, but like there's just, people don't know what the claims of Jesus are.
Yeah, it's far more in the press, isn't
it's
it?
It's gonna be better than your question.
Yeah, I'm sure it is. Thank you.
So I had this deepest wish, really, to be able to pronounce your last name, but I'm not going to try.
Was that the question?
That's not the question. But I would have liked to leave with that. So my question is centered around the topic of gender and sexuality. So this is the question. In your lecture, you were talking about that sometimes as Christians in this culture, we might have this attitude of laying low and wait until the tide washes over. So then my question was that if Christians stop voicing their voice, and are they losing their saltiness? And we are supposed to be the light. I'm reading The Cost of Discipleship by Bonhoeffer, and he's saying he's not saying you must be the light or you will be the light. He's saying you are the light right now. So what are you supposed to do? You're supposed to shine. What does that look like? So it's the question that I'm asking is what are your thoughts on freedom of speech and cancel culture where even Christians are like, oh, maybe we shouldn't really, really like that. That would get us in trouble, or we don't want to offend someone.
Yeah, yeah.
So.
No, great, great question. And this really is, so questions of gender and sexuality today are where the rubber hits the road, actually, because in Cambridge, Massachusetts, people do not care. If I believe that Jesus is the Son of God, they're like, great, knock yourself out. Like, you do you, fine. I'm glad it makes you happy, kind of thing. If I say that according to Christian ethics, it is morally wrong to sleep with somebody of your same sex, and that you cannot marry somebody of your same sex, then that's no longer, you know, isn't it sweet that you believe that? Enjoy. It's actually, no, you are a hateful person who is causing active harm to others, which is it's not a fun place to be. It's not a fun place to sort of have that leveled at you, for sure. And I think many Christians today who do believe what the Bible says about the kind of unpopular and countercultural things the Bible teaches when it comes to sex are afraid to ever have that conversation, or to, you know, that they dread anybody asking them, what do you think about this, about these questions? And I understand that, because it's a hard place to be. But as I was mentioning earlier, Christian sexual ethics isn't just like a random idea, like a random sort of set of laws that God gave for no particular reason. It's actually all ultimately comes back to this gospel metaphor of Jesus and his people. I mean, one of the things I sometimes say to people is like, Christian sexual ethics is weirder than you think. It's not just that I believe that sex only belongs in marriage between one man and one woman for life, but it's that I believe this is ultimately about a metaphor of Jesus' love for his people. Crazy, right? And so I think that the gospel actually lies at the heart. I don't think you can talk about Christian sexual ethics without talking about Jesus. Like, he's actually at the center of that. And also, I don't think there is a way to be a faithful follower of Jesus and avoid ever being falsely accused of bad stuff. I mean, that's actually something that Jesus told his followers would happen. Now, you need to be really careful to not be a jerk. Like, I mean, honestly, one of the verses that I particularly love in one of the Apostle Peter's letters, he says that as Christians, you should always be ready to give a reason for the hope that you have, but you should do so with gentleness and respect. Mm. Now, respecting somebody doesn't mean agreeing with them or affirming everything they believe, but it does mean respecting them. And gentleness means gentleness. So when Christians, and sometimes I hear Christians today talking of like, well, people out there are sort of playing dirty and like fighting rough, and so we should fight rough back. And I'm like, have you opened a Bible recently? Because Jesus very specifically says that that's not what we should do. We need to, if we're followers of Jesus, we need to take up the weapons that he has given us. And those are the weapons of love and prayer and humility. And they're actually quite powerful if you wield them well.
Thank you.
And by the way, my last name is pronounced McLaughlin.
I can just...
All together now? McLaughlin.
My husband's family says McLaughlin, but they're wrong. You know, what can I say?
Thank you, sir.
I have friends, a Christian couple, male and female, exploring marriage, where one of them has no heterosexual desire. Do you have one of your writings that would be helpful for them, or would you recommend someone else?
Oh, good question. So just to make sure I'm understanding you correctly, you have friends who are considering marrying each other.
Yes.
But one of them only has same-sex desire, or
yes.
Doesn't have... Okay, yeah.
Yes.
I think it would very much depend I don't think I've written anything. I've written things that might be helpful to them but aren't directly addressing that. I would, if I were their friend, want to talk through with them, you know, have very honest conversations about where they are and what they're thinking. I don't think there is any, I think if they wanted to get married, I don't think there's any kind of biblical reason to not do that. I do think biblically that sex is part of marriage, and so I think getting married with no intention of having sex would actually be not, biblically speaking, getting married. But we can desire things in a whole range of different ways. You know, I can desire to be loving towards somebody I don't even like, and I can make those decisions, and that may be the decision that they want to make. But I would have to sit down with them and have like a more holistic pastoral conversation to give any meaningful help.
Do you think your best friend's book might be helpful in this context?
My best friend's book's always helpful. If you wanted to read a fantastic book on Christian sexual ethics, but also on marriage and friendship and various other things, my friend Rachel Gilson wrote a book called Born Again This Way, Coming Out, Coming to Faith, and What Comes Next. Highly recommend.
Yeah, it's an extraordinary book. Over here, thank you.
Thank you. In section two, you concluded saying that the development leads to secularization hypothesis has failed, and that this is undergirds a bunch of other stuff in the secular idea space. What other stuff there?
Yeah, good question. So I think in the last few decades, the idea that the world is becoming less religious and that we just don't need to take Christianity seriously anymore has functioned not just as a diagnosis in the university, but as a prescription. So it's not like not just what will happen, but what should happen. And so the implications of realizing that it hasn't happened will impact a lot of things, not least the seriousness with which we take Christianity in the realm of philosophy. And there's some, I mean, if you go back a few decades to when Alvin Plantinga was first sort of doing his seminal work, and Nicholas Wolfsdorf and John Hare, sort of a handful of Christian philosophers made it sort of respectable for philosophers to believe in God again. That was how, I mean, a younger Christian philosopher friend of mine said, you know, them doing genuinely good sort of philosophy work that was recognized across the academy actually kind of made space for then more Christian philosophers to sort of speak about philosophical things from a Christian perspective. And so, you know, I think there'll be implications for that area of academic study. I think there are huge implications for the areas of study that connect with sexuality, not only in terms of sort of same-sex sexuality, but actually in terms of looking at today's sexual culture. I've recently finished reading a book called The Case Against the Sexual Revolution by a woman called Louise Perry, who's not writing from a Christian perspective, but is pointing out quite how bad the sexual revolution has been for women. And the sexual revolution in the 1960s was, you know, quite explicitly a repudiation of Christian sexual ethics. And it's gone very, very, very badly for everybody, but for women in particular. And you don't need to be a Christian to make that diagnosis. If you look honestly at the data, it's just facts. And I think the ways in which Christianity has been sort of dismissed in the university has meant and will mean that it takes longer for those academic disciplines to sort of catch up and figure out, oh no, there's something, the data is showing us that something is really wrong here. Or thinking about what leads to human flourishing in terms of psychology. Harvard School of Public Health has put out stacks of papers, and it's not just there, but it's one of the kind of main centers doing this kind of research, looking at the mental and physical health benefits of regular religious participation. To the extent that people who go to church every week have like a 30% reduced mortality over the next 15 years. I mean, like crazy levels of, you know, all the things that our culture is desperate for, the sort of better mental health, more happiness, lower levels of suicidal ideation, better physical health, all these things that we're crying out for as a culture, that actually regular religious participation is correlated with those things in a way that doesn't seem to be just explainable even by just the social elements. So I think that's a whole field of study as well that's going to have to kind of rethink itself. Either the, you know, field of psychology and mental health and wellness is going to have to stop dismissing Christianity because there's just too much data to show that people who go to church every week are happier, healthier, and longer lived than people who don't. That would be some examples come to mind.
Thank you.
Hi, Rebecca. My name's Hunter. I'm a local youth pastor here. I have a real passion for serving students. One of the big issues right now in student ministry is the idea and the concept of sexual identity and gender identity. And I was just wondering if you had any tips or any insight on how to deal with the pronoun crisis or if a student identifies as something as other than human.
Yeah, I'm going to take just like one little piece of that because I could talk for like the next hour and we don't have time for that. So in the last few years, as I'm sure everyone in this room is aware, there's been a massive upswing in the proportion of especially younger people who are identifying as something other than their biological sex. And if you look back sort of historically, you'll find that gender dysphoria is a real experience that people have, can be a profoundly painful and difficult experience. And it's something that it historically has been very much, not exclusively, but predominantly an experience of males who from early childhood felt a sense of deep disconnection with their body, their sort of sex body, and like they didn't kind of fit as a boy in the world. That some proportion of those folks that resolved for them as they went through puberty and into adulthood, and some proportion it didn't, and it was something that they've kind of carried for the whole of their lives. In the last few years, we've seen this sort of massive upswing in the proportion of people in general who are identifying outside of their biological sex, but in particular young women and adolescent girls who may never have shown any signs of sort of gender dysphoria at an earlier age, who at age, you know, 13, 14, 15, 16, whatever, start identifying as non-binary or as gender fluid or as a trans boy rather than as a girl. And there are a lot of things that I think it's important to kind of think through pastorally if you're coming from a Christian perspective to these questions. But there are also some things that we need to think through that actually somebody who's not a Christian at all could be coming, you know, we could kind of be looking at this together. Because if we divorce the idea of gender and what it means to be a man or what it means to be a woman from biological sex to where a biological man who identifies as a woman is just as much a woman as I am, you know, the claim that transgender women are women and should be treated as women in every context. If we do that, then we actually don't know what a woman is. We have no stable definition of a woman at all. All we have actually is gender stereotypes.
Yeah.
And there's a lot more that I would want to say about that because I think there are ways in which how Christians have talked about maleness and femaleness has very much played into what we see today in the sort of broader culture where we've taken things, I was talking about this earlier. I'm going to make John stand up because this is fun. So one of the things you'll notice about me and John is that I'm a girl and he's a boy, and I'm taller than him, even when I'm not wearing heels. Now, on average, I'm tired of sitting down, so I'm standing up for a second. On average, men are taller than women. But just because John is shorter than me doesn't mean that he's not a man or that I'm not a woman. We know, like, we intuitively know that it is true that men are taller than women, and that what we mean by that is, on average, men are taller than women, not that it is essential to maleness to be tall and essential to femaleness to be short. But what has often happened in church contexts and is absolutely happening in the sort of transgender movement, is making certain psychological characteristics that have been associated with maleness and femaleness, often because, on average, men are more like this and women are more like that. We've made those sort of essential to maleness or femaleness. And if you do that, if you ultimately are saying, and one way I saw it described once on Twitter by someone who's not a Christian, they were sort of saying, it's like a secular version of a soul, where I'm sort of talking as if I'm, you know, maybe I have a female body, but actually my soul is male, and so I'm more truly a man than I am a woman. We sort of need this construct of this sort of sex self that is apart from my body. And as I said, once we do that, we've lost any stable definition of what a woman is. We've lost any meaningful protection for women in women's spaces. We've lost women's sports, which is much less big a deal in England, because we don't care about sports that much in England, except football, which is soccer. That's a whole other thing. But, you know, really big deal in America. But I think it's really important to think, you know, as we maybe are talking with a young person or an older person, or maybe this is some people in this room, who are really struggling with their sense of maleness or femaleness, to actually listen to where that is coming from in their own life. And mm-hmm. Maybe they were raised in a church which had a very kind of rigid sense of this is what men are meant to be like and this is what women are meant to be like, and they always felt like, you know, they were a man and they just didn't fit. And so their church has actually trained them to believe that they're not really a man or they're not really a woman. I think it can be easy for Christians to become dismissive and to lack kind of genuine care and curiosity about where people's feelings are coming from. And I can absolutely acknowledge that somebody might be struggling with the very real experience of gender dysphoria while not acknowledging that they are in fact a man or a woman if that doesn't align with their biological sex. So it's just like a few thoughts.
Oops. We'll try to get through all three, these three. We might only get two, but you're on first. Thank you.
Thank you for everything you've shared this evening already. I hope to live in the United Kingdom one day and wondered if you had any advice on how to approach English people as you talked about with their kind of relative truth idea and being very respectful of that's your faith. How do you approach gospel conversations with them? And then I also wanted to ask if you could just give any insight into where the English church is.
Oh, gosh, the English churches. Great questions. You know, I think when it comes to evangelism anywhere in the world, there are some highly novel strategies that we need to put in place, which turn out to be not highly novel at all, but exactly what the New Testament is calling us to, which is things like love and hospitality, and welcome and generosity and talking clearly about who Jesus is and how we found hope in him. And I think those things work in England just like they work in America. You might have to, I mean, part of my husband's argument as to why we should move to America instead of staying in England was, he was like, as an American in England, I feel like I'm always sort of a bit under suspicion. As a Brit in America, people will love you for no reason. So there is a little edge of that, and I apologize for it in advance. Where the church in England is, I'm very discouraged by some recent moves in the Church of England. I think, I mean, thankfully there's a lot going on in England that isn't in the Church of England, and there are also a lot of Church of England churches who would not be aligned with the current top leadership of the Church of England, because they've done the world's most Anglican thing, which is, I mean, when I say, on a trial basis, the Church of England has decided to bless same-sex marriages. On a trial basis, I don't even know what that means. Like, well, how are you going to figure out if the trial worked or not? Like, it's bewildering to me, but it's also, it's just a very English kind of fudge of a situation. I'm making that sound funny. It's like deeply sad to me, actually. I think we are letting a lot of people down. So that's not encouraging.
Thank you.
You mentioned that you have sort of gathered a collection of people who have gathered around you who have same-sex interests or whatever that you've been able to be in community with. Do you have advice on how a local church can be welcoming and loving and some practical tips to that? In the doors, out of the doors. I mean, my husband's a pastor and we're very much into getting to know your community and your neighbors, and that's how the gospel spread. But how do we get our people, but how do we also get within our church, but others to recognize that, like, this is a group we need to love, and how do we practically welcome and do that?
Yeah, thank you. The first step, I think, is to recognize that, you know, say your church has 100 people in it. I don't know how big your church is, but let's say it's 100 people. Most likely 10 of those people experience same-sex attraction. If you don't know anybody in your church of 100 if you don't know this about anybody in your church of 100, it may well be the case that your church is not a church where people feel like this is something that they can talk about. And I think there are different ways. I actually don't think it's helpful for Christians to sort of wear their sexual attractions on a badge, in the sense of, like, for example, I'm open about the fact that I experience same-sex attraction. I actually think that's a sinful part of me. I don't think that's, like, a morally neutral thing. I don't think it's, like, a great thing that should be celebrated. It is an area of sin and temptation for me in my own, like, through my life, that I've found me talking about it has helped other people to think about their own attractions and also how to maybe help friends. So that's, you know, why I'm talking about it, rather than because I think this is, you know, a great thing to be kind of celebrated. So I'm not saying, and I think churches can sort of come, sometimes get into that posture, which isn't helping anybody, I think. But I think making our churches places where people feel like they can talk about the things that they struggle with is incredibly important to our own discipleship, and it's also then important to our witness to the world outside. So as just a little example in my own life, I've been having conversations the last year with one of the baristas at my local coffee shop who identifies as atheist and is also a lesbian, and she and I developed a lovely friendship, and I routinely have coffee with other friends of mine there and introduce her to them. And it so happens, I'm introducing her to a succession of people whose testimonies are of coming to Christ from a background of same-sex sexual relationships. And so as she hears about Jesus from me, the potential for her to think, well, I'm just a homophobic bigot who doesn't understand and whatnot, is kind of not there, because she's not only got my own story, but also the stories of all my friends. And I'm not even orchestrating this. It's really just like, I happen to be my friends. But yeah, so I think thinking through your own church culture, and is this a place, and I think in many churches it is easier for somebody to confess a pornography addiction than it is for them to talk about their experience of same-sex attraction. And I actually think it's vital that people should be able to confess their pornography addictions and get help. But I think we all need to be able to talk about what we struggle with.
Thank you. Final question.
Thank you very much for coming and bringing your lecture for us to hear. I was wondering what your response would be to how, even in social sciences, and I was specifically thinking psychology, in a Christian context, are affirming either same-sex attraction with, as they would be working in conjunction with the Bible as they're being taught in Christian domains, or affirming transitions to the opposite gender or what have you, what your thoughts are on that?
I'm not sure I fully understand. So what are my thoughts on when people are...
On the affirmation from Christian professors and psychologists that this is the fact that they are Christians, and but they use the science to support these things and the Bible by association.
Oh, so if I'm understanding you correctly, what do I think of Christian professors or academics who are saying, pointing to what, like, psychological positives or of affirming same-sex sexual relationships or like psychological negatives of not doing so? Is that...
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah, I think the reality is that people who identify as LGBT have higher levels of depression, anxiety, suicidal ideation, etc., on average, than their peers who don't. Now, that data, that's just the facts here, yeah. So then the question comes, what is causing that? And there'll be people on one side who would say, well, clearly this is all caused by the homophobia and the transphobia in the culture or in the church or like in the environment. And really, it's the fault of those around, you know, these folks, that this is how they're struggling. People on the other side would say, well, actually, no, it's people kind of living into these attractions is actually detrimental to their mental health and happiness. You know, we can hear people saying that on both sides. And my guess is that there's actually a bit of both those things happening in certain contexts. And there's also a lot of people who have experienced a lot of trauma and people who, especially with some of the trans identification at the moment, because identifying as trans in one form or another is being sold to young people in particular as the kind of solution to what they may already be struggling with in terms of mental health. We've had a lot of kind of papering over of real issues that people ought to be getting help, like real meaningful help with. We've been sort of, I think there's been a kind of misdiagnosis of a lot of people in this area. I don't think there's any like blanket statement to be made. I think every individual is an individual with their own story and their own history, and there is no kind of one-size-fits-all to account for any individual's experience. But I think it's worth us kind of looking at the data and thinking through, you know, what does love look like, which is always the question Christians should be asking. What does it look like to love whoever this person is? If somebody is coming from the perspective of being a Christian teacher, and they are teaching that the Bible affirms same-sex sexual relationships, they're in fact misleading people. They may be very well-intentioned, but they are doing people a serious disservice and misleading them. And so it actually grieves me deeply, because we're never going to be more loving than Jesus. Jesus is extremely serious in how he talks about sexual sin. And the Bible is painfully clear that same-sex sexual relationships are sinful, as are opposite-sex sexual relationships outside of lifelong marriage. And if we start calling something good, which the Bible calls evil, then we are affirming people in sin, and that's a profoundly unloving thing to do. And it's a highly unpopular thing to say in our kind of culture today. And I don't say it with sort of relish at all. But I think it's the truth.
You can tell that the Questioning Christianity series is not really designed to just be cool and to go with, you know, the popular view, but grapple with serious questions in a serious, intellectual, but also generous manner. And I think Rebecca has exemplified that. Our next in the series is on the 10th of April. So we'd love to see you back here for that. It won't be nearly as good as tonight, because it's me, not Rebecca. But the topic is one that I've had many skeptical friends over the years raise. Aren't there too many versions of Christianity to take any one of them seriously? The Catholics don't agree with the Orthodox, don't agree with the Baptists, don't agree with the Methodists, don't agree with the Pentecostals, and so on. Why should I take your religion seriously if you can't even agree what you believe? Is there a core Christianity? That's the question that I'll try and approach on the 10th of April. But before then, will you please thank Rebecca McGaughan.